Hi, good evening. Thank you everyone for coming tonight. My name is Eric Eby. I'm the Parking and Transportation Engineer with the Department of Public Works here in the city. This meeting is being sponsored, put on by the Department of Public Works. This is the initial public project initiation meeting for the Islington Street Corridor design. This is the first step in the design process. In previous years, we have worked on conceptual designs and with charrettes, and through the process, we've come up with the Islington Street Action Plan Matrix in 2009. And now we're ready to bring it forward to actual design of the corridor. And then after the final design, we would go into the construction phase. Just want to introduce you to who's here tonight. Our consultant with VHB is Greg Backus, and he's got several other colleagues in the audience. From the city, we have Terry Damaris, the city engineer, in the front row. And behind him is Ray. Oh, Ray. I can't pronounce. Our utility, he's assistant city engineer. And next to him is Juliet Walker, our transportation planner. And let's see, did I miss? Oh, Brenda Woodman is over here, our public outreach coordinator. Jim Hines from the fire department back there. Hi, Jim. And I don't think we have any new city councilors. I don't recognize the faces, but if they are here, welcome. And we'd like to just, we'll throw it over to Greg, and he'll bring you through what the process will be for the project. And after that, we'll probably go into some questions and answers, and possibly break up into groups and look at the plans in more detail. But with that, I'd like to thank everyone for coming, and I'll turn it over to Greg Backus at VHB.
Thank you. Good evening. before I roll into some slides, I just want to say that this is a relatively manageable size group. So if I'm rolling along and you don't understand something, raise your hand, stop me. We'll keep it fairly informal. Don't stop me for too long because I have a lot of slides. And as Eric said, we may break up into groups where we'll sit around some of the plans and have you maybe give us some of your ideas and maybe do a little writing on some of the plans. But as Eric described this meeting, this is a project initiation meeting. We have not done any design yet. We've done a lot of data gathering. We've attended past meetings on Islington Street on the corridor. I recognize some of you. And so we're still in the absorbing phase, I guess. And we want to hear your input. We want to know what your vision is for the corridor. So in a nutshell, that's why we're here. So let me run right into some slides. You have agendas in your hands, but we've kind of talked about the meeting purpose. The project team I'll talk about, who is your consultant that you hired, and then we'll go through the scope in a little bit of detail so you know what we're doing here. And then at the end, we'll talk about issues and opportunities within the corridor, and maybe breakout sessions if you have the endurance. So the meeting purpose is to explain our scope of work, what we're going to be doing, and then give you an opportunity to tell us what you think about the corridor and what should happen. So the project team, the consulting side, VHB, we are the project managers. We are the roadway and sidewalk and streetscape designers, but we have sub-consultants. The chief one is Underwood Engineers, located right here in Portsmouth. They will be doing the very complicated utility design and coordination. I don't envy them. Ransom Engineers will be doing geotechnical explorations for us. We're going to be doing roadway borings and sampling the soils underneath the project. Lee Carroll will be doing lighting design and power supply design. And then IAC will be doing cultural resources documentation. Her office is actually right on Islington Street. A little bit about VHB. We've been here before. We worked on the Maine-New Hampshire connection study, the Memorial Bridge. We have actually worked on the Islington Street corridor. Back in 1999, we did a traffic study. And then we've done some hard engineering in Portsmouth. We did the Route 33 project. And we have relevant experience in this type of project. These are three of my projects, downtown reconstruction projects, two in Vermont and one in northern New Hampshire. And then this is a recent one, just got finished in Somersworth. We did the streetscape component of Somersworth's downtown reconstruction project. Underwood has a long history of working in Portsmouth. They've done some pretty impressive amounts of utility design, sewer, water, drainage, that sort of thing. So this is the project we're talking about. The yellow line represents what is in our scope. We're doing Islington Street from the Route 1 bypass bridge that was just completed all the way to Maplewood Street, Maplewood Ave, roughly 1.1 miles. So these are the basic components of our scope: utility upgrades, roadway and sidewalk reconstruction, geometric improvements here and there, streetscape enhancements where possible, lighting design, traffic signal improvements at the two signalized intersections, ADA accommodations throughout. We need to comply with ADA, bike accommodations, and of course parking. So let's talk a little bit about the nitty-gritty utilities. Underwood will be designing new sewer, stormwater, water, gas adjustments, power adjustments, communication conduit adjustments. This is a photo from my Littleton project. Islington Street's gonna be a lot less disruptive, believe me. This is a real map of what's under just one intersection on Islington Street, the types of utilities. I don't think this even scratches the surface on how bad some of the areas are, how complicated. So Underwood right now will be initially trying to understand what's out there. They're going to examine the existing sewer system routing, which isn't always the most efficient. These systems were developed over 100 years or more, so they may want to reroute some of the lines. They'll identify where there may be sewer backups for different reasons. They're going to be doing house surveys and homeowner questionnaires. They need to understand for all of the buildings, both on Islington as well as on the systems that come into Islington, where the sewer lines come out of the houses, and hopefully to make improvements. So they'll be knocking on your doors. We'll be sending you letters, trying to arrange meetings where they can go into your basements and see, you know, what is the infrastructure within your house, where has it come out, what direction is it heading, and hopefully they can put two and two together to figure out what to do. They're also going to be looking at drainage systems and where is there currently flooding, if any, and then documenting pre-existing conditions that may need solutions. This is a tough-to-read map, but it shows some of the sewage system design. They've already done some data collection. In yellow, they've actually identified where drainage systems are connected into the sewer system, which we want to remedy under this project. This is an example of when they look at a property, they create a log of all the information for the types of utilities coming into that property or coming out of that property. And this is just a sample photo of what they're going to find in people's basements. And I should mention, too, that Islington Street, being a very old roadway, it would not surprise us to find some of the basements extending out underneath the sidewalks. It's very common in old cities where they used to have coal chutes into people's basements, and then frequently they maintained the space in the basement, but they covered it with a sidewalk. So we don't want contractors falling through a sidewalk when they're trying to replace it, and we really want to understand where some of those spaces might exist. And some of you may already know. This is an example of just their way, Underwood's way of keeping a log of which buildings they've been in and what the status is of each property as they go. And then private utilities. There's gas, electric, and telephone. This photo shows a telephone manhole in the middle of a sidewalk, which is a clear indication that there's a conduit running along the length of that sidewalk. So we need to be careful of what we design, like a new light pole, for instance, or a tree or something like that. We need to know what's under there. So they'll be documenting all of that. And then we're also, under this project, we are going to consider where it may be feasible to move some of the overhead utilities underground. You'll see in some of our other slides, and you're probably more familiar than I am, that there's really limited room in some of these sidewalks, and to be able to eliminate some of these massive utility poles would be a real blessing, both visually and otherwise, to at least the historic section of Islington Street. Comes at a high cost, but it's something that we're definitely going to look into. They've documented the gas lines. The orange line there just shows some of the supply lines. Doesn't show all the connections to the houses, but it's a good indication where the system is. Fairpoint has a number of utility duct banks leading from the Fairpoint hub, which happens to be on Islington Street. So in the vicinity of that building, the roadway is just full of their facilities. So some of these lines are going to be very deep in the road, some of the sewer, some of the potentially some of the stormwater, and we're going to be excavating earth. And we need to know if that earth is clean or not. So this is a map from New Hampshire DES that just shows where known hazardous material spills are. So I mentioned Ransom engineers will be doing exploration program, taking borings along the corridor. And so if they detect that some of these sites have spread underground, we need to know that, because it has cost implications to the project. You don't want a contractor excavating contaminated soils if you can help it. So it's something we need to do, document it as much as we can. They're also going to be doing over 40 borings just to know what's under the road. We know there used to be a trolley line on Islington Street. There may still be ties and track. There may be concrete. There may be a lot of different things. We had another similar reconstruction project in a downtown that the entire roadway was underlain by cobblestones. So we had to account for those. So we'll figure that out. We'll find out exactly what's down there. And then we're going to be reconstructing the road. So doing all this utility work, all these trenches, all of this excavation is going to make a shambles of the existing road structure. It's going to be a patchwork of patches. So when all the utility work is done, we're then going to replace the existing pavement. We don't know exactly yet to what depth, but it's likely to be a full depth reconstruction of the road, because it'll be such a mix once they're done with the trenching. So that gives us actually an opportunity. We're going to redo the road. We're going to reset all the curb. We're going to redo all the sidewalks. So what can we do different than what's out there? You know, we're going to look at the geometry. We're going to look at your roadway widths. We're going to look at can you modify some of the intersecting curb radii, that sort of thing. So when you have a project of this scale, you can come back and kind of do it right. You know, some of this has been out there more than 100 years. This is our chance to do it. This photo is a good photo because it highlights some of the impact that will be experienced during construction, during the different phases. So traffic management on a project like this is critical. You have between 10 and 20,000 cars a day that use Islington Street, especially now that the bridge is open. We need to manage that. So we have experience on how to do that best, and we'll be working with all of you to make sure it works. Pedestrian access shouldn't be ignored. And you've got sidewalks that are functioning on both sides, people getting to their residence or to the businesses along Islington Street. We need to maintain pedestrian access to the extent possible. So this is a throwback to 2009, the Islington Street Corridor Improvement Action Plan. These graphics are right out of the study. These show what some of the recommendations were. So at the beginning, I mentioned to you that we want to hear what your ideas are. And we also really want to kind of leverage off some of the planning that's already occurred. We don't want to ignore it. So I wanted to kind of review some of the things that were in that plan, some of the things, some of the great ideas that we would likely be, you know, moving forward with. So beginning at the southwestern end of the project by Route 1, the first thing they identified was realigning Spinney Street. Today, Spinney comes in at a really sharp angle. I don't know what the accident history is, but I'm guessing it's probably fairly high. And there's a great opportunity to to tee that up so it's more of a right angle coming into Islington Street. That should slow vehicles coming off of Islington onto Spinney and vice versa, and make that a safer intersection. I'm going to use the term bump outs a lot, also known as bulb outs or curb extensions. What that is at a crosswalk, it's a location where you essentially bump the curb out, the width of a parking space typically, so that that pedestrian, when they want to cross, are more visible to motorists. They have a shorter crossing. And those bump outs also provide you an opportunity to put a street light, perhaps, or a tree. And they tend to calm traffic a little bit. When you have curbing coming into the road, makes people slow down a little bit. So throughout the project, the 2009 plan recommends bump outs at the pedestrian crossings. And we support that. I think it's a great opportunity on this corridor to make an improvement at the crossings. And then the study also recommends public-private partnerships to implement streetscape improvements outside of the existing right-of-way. The existing Islington Street right-of-way is really pretty narrow. There's limited space to be doing tree planting, to be doing, you know, anything really nice when you only have a 5-foot sidewalk. So one way to make the corridor a little more interesting, a little more people-friendly, is to look at the space immediately outside of that sidewalk, you know, on private property, and work with those landowners, potentially, you know, either to assist with making improvements or to help them plan their improvements so they work better with what we're designing. So that's a good concept. Moving further along to the east, the Bartlett Street intersection, the recommendation was to realign Bartlett Street. So it would be opposite, what's the name of the street across the street? Jewel Court, yeah. Making it a perfect four-way intersection has a lot of advantages from a traffic perspective, and it would eliminate some of the skew that's on Bartlett today and make it a more of a conventional intersection with better pedestrian crossings and that sort of thing. So it's something we'll look at. And a few of the things I've already mentioned require right-of-way acquisitions. And, you know, I don't want to downplay that. It's not an easy thing. It can be expensive, but something like realigning Bartlett Street would directly impact an existing business. So, you know, that's something we have to weigh. Further along, again, planted bump outs. Planted means put a tree in it, or some sort of greenery in the bump out at Cass Street, and then also at Columbia. Then further along, bump outs at Cabot, which is a signalized intersection. We like that idea. It's a very standard four-way intersection. I think putting bump outs there and redoing the signals would make that a great little improvement for that intersection. Planted bump outs at Goodwin Park. Now, Goodwin Park is it's a destination for a lot of pedestrians, and it would be really nice to improve the crossing there of Islington Street right at the park. If not one, maybe all three. So that's a great opportunity. And then the report mentions public art. You know, to the extent that we have space, that would be great. You know, we're trying to enhance Islington Street in any way we can, and I've already mentioned that the right-of-way is kind of tight, but there's other things you can do. Adding public art would be nice. And then headed towards the end at Maple, realign Summer Street. That's another one that it comes in, and it's hard to see at this graphic. It's down on the left here. Comes in at a bit of a skew. It'd be really nice to tee it up a little bit better, a little more of a right angle. Again, more bump outs, and then there was a note to add a bus pullout over at the elderly housing, the Bridge Tanner block, actually. Just a photo of one of our projects where, you know, this is a typical bump out. It also has a durable crosswalk, which is really recognizable. Here's another one. It shows what you can do with plantings. You know, this is a really nice downtown solution. There never used to be a bump out here. It was just a crosswalk, a very long crosswalk. So adding a bump out creates a little space. And then at night, the restaurant that happens to be there has public seating, and it turns into a little gathering place where before it was dead. So there's opportunities that bump outs provide aside from just the enhanced crossing. This is another one, very typical. Notice the bike squeezing by. This particular one, we didn't make the bump out as wide as the parking space. We made it a foot less to accommodate bikes. And then this is a visualization we created for Islington Street, showing actually at Brewster, this is what it would look at with bump outs and trees in the bump outs and an enhanced crosswalk. So streetscape amenities, I've touched on some of them. Trees and plantings, where you can fit them. Lighting, so lighting can be a challenge here. You have utility poles. If we don't go underground with the utility poles, you're gonna have low hanging wires, at least on one side of the road at all times. This is an example though, I think this is either Court or State Street, where if you put a pedestrian size, like a 10 or a 14 foot light pole, you can still have it be below the hanging wires as long as you can, you know, get those wires up high enough. So you can kind of have both if you have you know, utilities that will accommodate a light pole like this. Gateways. Haven't talked about gateways, and if we break out into groups, we can talk about them a little bit more. But what a gateway is physical features that you've added on the roadway, typically as at the entrance or exit to a corridor, or maybe at a key spot in the middle. And the gateway can be anything from you know, big plantings to banner poles. There's a lot of different things, or a sign saying, you know, welcome to Portsmouth or something. But it's kind of a streetscape amenity that signals arrival into a different zone or a different corridor. And it's something that, you know, can enhance your little corridor here. So bike racks would be nice. You know, we need to figure out where they should be, where they can fit. Street furniture, similar thing. And where's a good spot for street furniture so people can sit? And then we should have a big discussion about sidewalk materials. In the historic district, you have a lot of brick sidewalks, which are beautiful. I don't know if you envision brick for part of or all of Islington Street, maybe just the historic section of Islington Street, but it's certainly one of those things we'll have a conversation about. Wayfinding signs. I know you have a whole separate project that is doing wayfinding design, and actually the sign that's in this image is from that study. So wayfinding is great because now people will be able to tell at a glance where parking is, where there are amenities, you know, down different side streets, that sort of thing. So that will add a lot. I mentioned traffic signals. We'll be replacing and upgrading the signals at Bartlett and Cabot Street. I know a few of the places where there are signals, well, a few of the signals within those two intersections, there may be visibility restrictions right now where you can't necessarily see the signal heads real well. So we'll upgrade everything to current standards, including the pedestrian crossing, actuation, and that sort of thing. It's a great opportunity to do that. Bike and pedestrian accommodations. This is a great picture. There's really not a lot of room on Islington Street to do any kind of dedicated bike lanes. Certainly sharing the road is encouraged, and maybe we'll put shared lane markings out there, similar to what you have in the downtown some streets. But again, there's no real room to do like separated bike paths or bike lanes. I love this picture. It's complete streets at its best. Kids on the sidewalk on bikes, the runner going around them, the guy walking the dog, the truck not completely in the driveway, utility pole. So there's a lot of things going on in this picture that, you know, we're going to try to address. This is an image of the 2014 Bike and Pedestrian Master Plan, just to confirm that plan, the recommendations for Islington were do the bump outs at the intersections to improve pedestrian connectivity, but not to do anything special on Islington with regard to bike accommodations, and definitely upgrade and replace all of the sidewalks. So a few photos just to show you what's out there. Love this one. Really tight cross-section. You have narrow sidewalks with only limited space to put your utilities. You can see this one has a steel collar that's already broken. You can imagine how that happened. And we have a lot of this utility poles in the curb line. By state standards, you normally would have it 18 inches behind the curb line, but we don't have that kind of room. You also have to remove snow here or, you know, do sidewalk plowing, so you're kind of caught in between. And there's a lot of places where we'll look at access management, and by that, there are a lot of parking lots immediately adjacent to Islington Street with zero control, no curb cuts, just wide open curb, or wide open cut. So we'll look at places where it may be possible to formalize where the drive entrances would be. I think there's definitely some improvement that can be made along the way. And sidewalk space, I've mentioned it a lot. There's so much that could happen here. The photo on the left is the White Heron coffee shop. We're closing that. No. I know coffee shops are like high on everybody's list, but this is a great photo that shows just adding a couple benches, you know, makes this more of a human space and more attractive to people. It's a social gathering kind of place. The photo on the right shows, again, how tight it is, but it also shows the private property has a planter. So as part of this project, we're going to be looking at where's all the green potential along the roadway. It may not be city-owned, but there are places where plantings do occur. And here's another example. There are some plantings that are on private property. You know, the trees may not be in great shape, but it's something anyway. You're not just looking at a barren streetscape. And this is how not to build a brick sidewalk. Adjacent landscape, sometimes they need pruning too. This is an overgrown arborvitae, and it looks great. It's encroaching on the public sidewalk, so we need to look at all that. And then there's just areas where you don't know where the road or the sidewalk begins. You know, where's a person walk? Look at the utility poles. How does the sidewalk plow get around some of these? It's a challenging corridor, but it as a photo like this shows, it's in great need of, if nothing else, reconstruction and formalizing what's there, putting a curb in a place like this, putting a nice sidewalk. Parking and transit, I know parking can be a lightning rod on projects. We would look to, you know, this community to find out on Islington Street exactly how important is the parking. Does the parking need to be reviewed? Does it need to be changed? I know you have a parking garage planned very close to Islington Street. That's good. Here's an example of a handicap space. You know, are there enough handicap spaces? Are there too many? Are they in the right places? And where are the transit stops? Where do the buses stop now? How do they stop? Are they at the best locations? It's very tough in a place like this to create actual pullouts for buses. There's really not enough room. So I know some of the buses just pull up and discharge passengers by the side of the road, like in a place like this. So we'll be looking at all of that. And we're going to do this within some of the greater context. There's been quite a bit of planning outside of the right-of-way as well. How many people attended the February design charrettes for the Islington Corridor? All right, I knew I recognized some people. That was a great exercise. It came up with great recommendations relative to character-based code. What does that mean to us for the Islington Corridor? This is actually one of the recommendations, the preliminary plan for the West End. Islington is where my hand is, my arrow, going along there. So this is all happening in the background to what we're designing. It's something that's going to happen over a great amount of time when parcels redevelop. I guess I can say that for our design, we're not going to do anything that prevents it. It's very hard for us to do anything that adds to it, though. You know, we're limited to our right-of-way that's only so wide, but we certainly want to complete our design aware of it. And if there's anything that the character-based code, you know, comes to us, if any developer comes to us and say, hey, you know, how can we partner and make this nice green space next to Islington Street, we'll say, all right, let's do that. So just want you all to be aware that we were there, we were involved, we want to, you know, bring those thoughts into our project where we can. This is the same study down in the historic district. It's a lot more constrained through this area, not as much opportunity as the West End. But again, we'll be open to any suggestions. This is one of their images, and I put this one up. This is Islington Street right here. So this is what I'm talking about. You know, we have control over everything up to the right-of-way line, up to the property line, but look how much can happen beyond there. So the idea would be, in a case like this, that whatever we design can just flow into that. If that's a public space, maybe we need to put more crosswalks, or maybe we need to have our sidewalk designed so that it can be expanded into that public space. So just an example, it's out there. We'll be aware of it. I show this because this map shows what the historic district boundary is. For Islington Street, it begins at Bartlett and heads to Maplewood. And that's very consistent to the type of development you see out there. You know, you have the homes up close through the eastern end, historic homes. It becomes a little more commercial as you get towards Bartlett, and then beyond Bartlett, it's not historic at all. It's mostly commercial areas. There are a few historic mill buildings out that way, but so that's just something to be aware of. I mentioned maintenance of traffic. We've been through this on several downtown projects. It's something that you shouldn't fear if you're a business owner. It's something we can manage. It's something you start thinking about early. You don't wait until the bids are out for construction. It's something we start thinking about now because we're tasked right now with doing preliminary design for the entire 1.1 miles. Something that's going to happen while we're doing that is we're going to decide with the city which contract to break out first, because this project's going to probably be built in phases. So when we make those decisions, we're going to be looking at how we're going to manage traffic. How disruptive is this going to be? Which blocks make the most sense to do together? Is it better to do as much as you possibly can and go away, or do you need to do it in small little segments because of the funding? So we'll help you all through that. There are some of the techniques we use during construction to manage traffic. Obviously, maintain two lanes whenever you can, whenever possible. You sometimes have to go to alternating traffic where you let one lane go and then you let the other lane go. You have flaggers or a temporary signal in the middle, that sort of thing. This roadway has so much traffic, though, that's going to be pretty tough. You might be able to do it during off hours. We very often restrict the construction limits, so the whole darn road isn't dug up at once. If you did that, think about it, you'd lose parking on the whole road. You'd have a lot of pain spread out over a big distance. We'd rather focus the pain on short stretches. Consider short-term detours. Are there ways to detour people around some of the most intensive construction activities? And then consider the parking impacts. We want to manage parking almost as much as traffic in certain areas. And then keep the public informed. I see we have a public relations person here. She's going to earn her money when things are under construction. And actually, on some of our projects, we've had a full-time liaison person who walks the street, keeps in touch with everybody, and makes sure that information is going both ways on what's working, what's not. So the other thing we can do is make sure our contract documents are written very tight so that the contractor doesn't have any wiggle room on what he does out there. We control what he does and when. during the construction. You can consider doing incentives and disincentives to speed the project up. It's amazing how they can go fast if there's money involved. Work in compact work zones, I mentioned that. Defining the work hours. You know, some communities say, you know, we don't mind if he's out there for 12 or 16 hours if it'll shorten the duration of the project. We don't mind if he works weekends, if it'll get him out of here in August instead of November. So there's things like that that we can control. one of my projects, we did public meetings during construction on a weekly basis. Every Thursday morning, the contractor would come and meet before the public and explain what he was going to do the following 7 days. He also received input, good or bad, during that period, and it was great. The first meeting, there were about 50 people there. Halfway through, there was probably five. We gained the public's trust by having the contractor involved with the public. We also televised those meetings on local cable so people could see it from home, and then they knew which roads to avoid that week. I mentioned the community liaison officer. And then, I think critically, mobilizing the project supporters. Don't just leave it up to the public works and your consultant and your contractor to get this project done effectively. If you have a merchants group or a West End group, get them involved too. There's a lot of things that the local people can do to help smooth out the construction period. My last slide, I think. So keys to project success here. We want to develop creative but also realistic solutions. We want to really coordinate all these utilities. It is one of the most challenging aspects of this project. Consider the greater context, like I just mentioned, with regarding to the character-based code. Prepare in advance for construction and maintain all of your interest and contact throughout. So we'd like to share your thoughts now. Would you all like to just have an open forum? Maybe hear each other's comments as opposed to breaking up into groups? Okay, that'd be great. So, comments, questions.
Thank you. I was just wondering what impact the fact that half of the project is in the historic district. How does that impact what you have to do or decisions?
Yeah, sure. We'll be working within the public right of way, so we don't anticipate direct impacts on historic properties. There may be some temporary impacts. You know, we may have to do a drive apron over or something like that, or you know, wiggle with somebody's stairway, things like that. But what we do within the public right of way, I think the material choices we make might need to be reviewed and approved. I mentioned the brick sidewalks. You know, maybe even the streetlights need historic, you know, review, that sort of thing. So that I think it wouldn't prevent the project in any way, but it would certainly help us make design decisions.
I've got it right here.
Okay. Pass it down.
I've made a list, but I won't do it all.
No, we have time. Yeah.
I would think we would do some form of period lighting, but with some comments. And I'm reflecting on what we have in downtown in Market Square.
Okay.
The period lighting is beautiful. The lumens are terribly inadequate at night. And anyone who's gone to, for instance, the recent Halloween parade, mm-hmm. you can't see anything downtown at night because we have this very subdued lighting. Mm. There has mm-hmm. to be adequate lumens for safety.
Yep.
And at minimum, we need better lighting at crosswalks. If we go subdued the rest of the way, we yep. need something that shows crosswalks.
Yep, I'm with you there. There are standards we're supposed to follow. And getting back to her question, they may be bent by the historic concerns. We'll have to figure that out, but I agree. The crosswalks in particular, there's no reason not to go with adequate lighting.
And is it possible that crosswalks might deserve to have the new innovation that actually has, when they're not at a signaled intersection, the push button that turns on a strobe so that drivers know somebody is attempting to cross as opposed to popping out off the curb suddenly?
Yeah, we'll look at that. It's very possible. You don't want to do it everywhere.
Okay.
It starts to get ignored. We'll look at key intersections, or actually where I like to put them is at mid-block crossings where the driver might not expect a pedestrian to cross.
I'm thinking of the one at Goodwin Park.
Yeah. Yeah, that's perfect. Right.
Okay. One final pie in the sky, and I'll maybe do some later if there's time.
Pie's good. Yeah.
I would love for us to look at the potential of acquiring some private land from people who might be willing to part with it. The Gibbs gas station was one we should have looked at acquiring when it was up for public auction or public bidding to make pocket parks and maybe some parking. Personally, I would approach all the gas stations on Islington Street and see if any of them would like to sell, because I think it would be a tremendous improvement if all three of them were gone.
Anybody here from Mobil or Shell? All right, thank you.
Being someone who walks Islington Street every day, what are the alternatives to brick sidewalks? This time of year, without any rain and the leaves on the sidewalks, they're already become slippery. What are some alternatives?
We've seen where people, designers, propose concrete that has a brick pattern or a brick color. Personally, I'm not a fan of the brick colorizing because it's very hard to get it right. It's very hard to make it last so it doesn't end up pink or something that looks like you tried too hard. We've done a brick pattern, actually a cobblestone pattern, and left it gray. And it actually added interest without looking too fake and much more durable and slip resistant than brick. And stable, I should say. It doesn't become a tripping hazard. So we'll throw out some ideas. There's other ideas. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. You mentioned Somersworth, and I'm familiar with that. And I really think that what you did there was just strikingly beautiful. The only thing I would say about it, though, is that I don't remember seeing any trees. And I understand what you're saying about a lot of times you can't because of what's underground. Have you thought about any alternate ways to get an upper canopy so that we can be shaded during the heat of the summer if you can't put a tree in?
Wow.
I'm thinking about things heating up in the summer, climate change.
Sure, yeah. I don't have an answer for that. What we would consider if we can't do trees because of underground utilities, we've done raised planters, big flower pots with, you know, bushes, shrubberies, that sort of thing. But it wouldn't give you a canopy. It's a whole different reason. Other than something structural, I don't really have an answer for you.
I have just a question about coordinating past work with future work.
Yes.
I live on Cass Street and just fairly recently went through the sewer separation and this huge project all over Cass Street and Albany Street and that whole region, and I guess I thought it was over. In the planning for that, is it when you, I just got a little teeny bit alarmed when you started talking about the separation, which makes sense, and redoing all the sewer lines along Islington. Is that going to spill over again into areas that the city just finished?
No.
At least connect? Well, I don't mean in a big way, but in the connectors at the intersections and stuff?
Maybe at the intersections. Depends on where they left off. If they left a stub into an old system, we would pick it up from that stub and keep going. I don't know the details of what's been done at Cass, but I would think that if it's been fixed, we're not going to refix it.
I was thinking more about intersections.
Yeah, the intersections, quite likely, yeah. Yep.
The work on Cass Street in terms of the overall sewer separation is complete. So there will be some coordination right at that intersection with Islington Street, but both Albany, Cass, that portion of the work, and down at Bartlett has all been done in terms of sewer separation.
But there'll be some, at those intersections, things are going to get back up.
Just at the intersections, yes.
I don't know if it actually would be a question for you as opposed to the city answering some questions. I would assume that Bartlett Street, the work that we had a couple of years ago, is part of that same thing. Plus, as far as going to the bridge, everything that was all redone, that has all been segmented to prepare for the separation, the water, the sewer. I'm just kind of making an assumption that that those places were done adequate enough to be able to go and continue on from there. And then just a couple of quick little things as far as bump outs. You know, bump outs are great. They're fine. They're wonderful. But we do live in a winter climate area. Mm-hmm. It does impact as far as with parking. I do like the fact with the bump outs of crosswalks, and they really come out. I mean, well, this is a challenging. We've been made aware recently that they've talked about doing, for speed control, about doing raised crosswalks, which is not a speed bump. It actually kind of slows down and I think is a little bit more favorable to the fire department and the police departments than it would be for just a regular speed bump. Speed is a big thing on this. I brought this up a little while ago. I was turned down on, I should say, from Plains baseball field to the bridge, which is where I am, about lowering the speed limit. And all of this here still is at 30 miles an hour and has been since I was 12 years old. This was never really discussed when it comes to that. And then the other quick comment basically would be is I love the fact of trying to get all of the utilities underneath ground, but Eversource just literally replaced almost all of those poles around the plaza, around right. Bartlett and everything, and you're going to have a heck of a time trying to convince them to redo what they just did. So
I think the city stopped them from going any further because they knew this project was coming along.
Yep.
Personally, I would think that from Bartlett towards Maplewood is where you'd want to do it, where you have the historic district, have more of an impact visually to that area. But I hear what you're saying. Yeah, they're not going to want to do anything twice.
So, I mean, you know, like the bump out, parking is going to be a big thing on this road.
Yes.
Because if you don't have it on this road, then we get into a crunch time where we do in other parts of the city where now it impedes into the residential neighborhood areas on Cabot, on Union, you know, all of that stuff. So.
We'll be looking, I'm glad you mentioned the bump outs and the parking impact. We'll be looking at the existing parking. Actually, the city's gonna do a inventory on Islington and to find out, are there any spaces that are already non-conforming? There are guidelines on how far a parking space has to be away from a crosswalk, for instance. My guess is there may be some that are less than that. When you do a bump out, now that formalizes that that car has to be further back. We would design our bump outs, and we have in the past, as smooth as we can so that plows can sweep in and out. You know, we don't like abrupt ones. And by doing that, it pushes that first car that's parked a little bit further away from the intersection. So I would anticipate a loss of parking here and there if there are non-conforming spaces today.
And you are aware of some of the other projects that are going on, like Old Port Traders.
Yes.
I'm assuming that hopefully
some
of the developer will be paying for that instead of just the taxpayers.
Thank you.
I'm a resident of Spinney Road.
Oh, yes.
And I'm very anxious to see that intersection at Islington Street modified because I find it almost impossible to look to the left and see the traffic coming from that end.
Yep. Thank you.
Just putting in my two cents with regard to the sidewalk material. I used to live on Islington Street around the corner from Union and Cabot, which has some brick material and have taken more than one fall on the slippery material there. It's also very difficult to shovel, not that many residents do, but some of us did, and it's difficult to work with. Yeah. With regard to the gentleman's comment regarding lumens, I don't really have a comment with regard to how intense the lighting is, but please remember that there are a lot of bedrooms and a lot of people trying to sleep, so if you're going to design historic lighting, thinking about keeping that from shining towards people's bedroom windows and directing it more towards the sidewalk and the roadway would certainly be appreciated.
We do that on a regular basis. It's possible to design your light fixtures so they have cutoffs on the building side that prevents the light from spilling directly in. I think there was a question right here. Oh, you.
I want to know what is the timeline on this. I'm with a nonprofit group that is working on a project for Islington Street, a tactical urbanism, where residents wouldn't be involved in temporarily redesigning part of the street. And we're quite a ways from actually funding it, but we were looking at next May, which is 7 months from now, and I wonder where you're going to be in your efforts.
Yeah, actually, I should explain what our immediate tasks are first, and then I'll build on that. We're going to be conducting a full topographic survey of the corridor. Very involved in an urban environment, it takes time. They are going to be starting in a week or two, so you'll see our survey crews out there surveying. So we're not going to be doing any hard design until we have those survey base plans sometime, you know, the end of December maybe. In the meantime, we're going to be doing conceptual design. One reason we wanted to have this meeting was to start fleshing out the issues, drawing some of these intersections on that base plan right there. We're going to be using those files to draw. So we're going to be coming back to you probably in the early spring, maybe February, to show you what some of our ideas are, what some of our design ideas are. It wouldn't be hard design at that point. And then we'll roll into what we call preliminary design to start nailing down some of the design features based on the feedback we get from everybody. The project is not currently funded for construction. We are only tasked to go through preliminary design, and then, like I mentioned earlier, we're going to probably identify a first construction project that we're going to break out and take it all the way to final. So I don't know if it's going to be where you're going to be doing your tactical design or not, but I think you have a little time. We're not going to be going beyond a point of no return within your time frame.
The group is PS21, I didn't say that.
Yep, thank you.
My other question was about design speeds. What sort of, could you talk a little bit about that and what sort of design speeds might be appropriate? Recently they just, the Traffic Safety Committee, based on Eric's analysis, decided that the design speeds for the upper part of the street were too fast to reduce the speed limit through signs.
Right, I think they did a speed study, right? And they determined that they couldn't reduce the speeds. So I would imagine we're going to be designing for what the city tells us with regard to posted speeds.
If I could, a couple of real comments, I guess. Number one, I noticed in one of those slides the Bridge Street parking lot, which is now a parking lot, was turned into a park.
Yeah, that was from the character-based code.
Right, right. I'd just like to make a comment on that. I live right across the street from that. I'm actually the last house, or the first house, depending on how you look at it, on Islington. If the street's going to be developed, it would seem to me to be a good idea to find some way to get people from across Congress Street onto Islington Street. I can tell you right now what happens, especially with visitors. They have their maps in their hands, and I see this all the time. Mm-hmm. They go to in front of the health food store, they look at the map, they look up and down the street, they turn around and they go back to Congress. Now Market Street and Market Square and Congress Street is getting more and more congested every single summer, especially. Now we love the tourists, but we would love to be able to spread it out a little bit so that we don't need to buy tickets to get on the sidewalk when that time comes. Mm-hmm. It just seems to me if you're going to get more businesses like Cafe Kelm or the sandwich shop or anything at all, you're going to want to get the people who are visiting this town to be able to see a destination. If they can't see that, Mm-hmm. They're not going to go. Mm-hmm. So I'm proposing at least turn half of that parking lot into a park. Be a great place to call it Islington Gateway or something like that. Even
right.
Halfway. Now, you're going to be building just in back of that, I believe, about a 600-space parking
correct.
Garage.
Yep.
So, yes, we will be losing some spaces, probably 30-some-odd spaces. But on the other hand, you'll be picking up a green space in the city that we need so very badly, especially mm-hmm. on Islington. The other comment I'd like to make, there's been some talk of making Islington one way and State Street one way. I think it should be at least considered. Mm-hmm. It may be a viable thing to do, maybe not, but I think the discussion needs to be had. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
While we're on the gateway.
You still have a list.
I still have a list. I think the gateway at the other end needs to be just below the bypass bridge.
Sure.
In some form.
I mean,
you leave a residential neighborhood, you cross the bridge into a commercial area.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think the gateway would serve its purpose any further out toward the ballpark,
right.
The intersection of 33. But I think mm-hmm. that's a great place to look at some gateway improvements.
Great, thank you.
One quick final comment on sidewalks. There need sidewalks and parking spaces kind of go together. There needs to be some delivery truck parking spaces. Either that, or we've got to build all our sidewalks to withstand UPS trucks.
Mm.
The photograph you showed of the brick sidewalk, I will bet week's pay is because of vehicles parking on the sidewalk. It's mm-hmm. rutted for the wheels that come up over the curb.
Mm-hmm.
And our design of handicap ramps makes it possible to park on any sidewalk anywhere because we've provided ramps to get up on them. Either that or we've got to improve enforcement after we build new
right.
sidewalks.
Mm-hmm. It's a harsh reality. Deliveries have to happen.
Would you continue your time frame? I'm not going to hold you to this, but would you take us to completion? Years? Months?
I might need help from the city on that one. Yeah.
So the project as a whole will be done likely in phases, but that's something that's going to be determined over time. So right now, as a schedule stands, currently VHB has a design contract to get about 60% of the way through the design. So as he mentioned earlier when he said that it was funded, it wasn't funded for construction. It's really more about their design component. There are capital funds set aside for portions of this work for both the final design and for portions of construction.
Mm-hmm.
The real question here is of that 1.1 million or 1.1 miles worth of roadway, what portion will be first, second, third, or if it'll be all part of one big project that gets built in sections. So that's something that's yet to be determined. But right now, this is kind of considered a 60% design. That'll be followed by a final design, and it'll be likely that somewhere in that time frame we'll make a decision on what portion is actually getting built, and then we'll start accumulating the capital funds, the additional capital funds that are needed to do that. So it's going to take a while, though, and we don't have the exact time frame yet.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
There was a tangential mention here of the city acquiring space along Islington Street for parking. It was sort of tangential, parking or parks.
Mm-hmm.
The word park is in both of them. It seems really important to me that we look to the future. I mean, this project is going to take quite a while. But this city is growing greatly, and if there's not some provision made for more parking out further on Islington, you're talking about parking in the new the downtown end of mm-hmm. Islington, but what about further out, like negotiating with Plaza 800 to double up on that space and go upwards with it or something of that sort? Or I know that in the past there's been discussion of acquiring parcels of land around Bartlett Street, maybe not by the city, but by commercial interests who would like to unify all that and do some commercial development there. But that would seem like another place that possibly some parking could be put to service the whole West End area, which, you know, parking is going to be a problem down the line if it's not already. Mm-hmm. And I just leave that as a comment. I came a little late, so maybe I missed the discussion about burying utilities. Obviously, it would solve a lot of the problems of space on the sidewalks and so forth. It also is very expensive. Mm-hmm. Did you discuss that? And if you did, am I out of line asking about it? Or can you give a probability of what is the probability that those utilities will all get put underground? Because they're pretty ugly, frankly, and they take up a lot of space.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to take a guess at the probability. We haven't even looked at it yet to come up with an estimate on what it would cost, and even in some areas whether it's even feasible. There's so much underground on Islington Street already. We would need to find space for all those utilities. I think the whole design team recognizes the benefit of it, so it's something we're going to give a real honest try, you know, to do it.
Thanks. This was a great presentation, by the way.
Thanks.
I put some thought into it. I appreciate it a lot. So Islington is already a skinny street, right? You mentioned
it
that
sure
a few
is.
Times.
Yep.
So emergency response vehicles, mm-hmm. in your almost 42-minute presentation wasn't even mentioned. So please consider when you're building the street, when you're confining it, traffic calming, bump outs, please remember that it's a pretty major artery and that we've got to get paid professional firemen and paramedics up and down that street.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right?
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yep.
I just want to know if I'll see this in my lifetime.
How's your health?
As we think of things, do you have like a website that we could send thoughts in or some way?
Yeah.
That we could...
In your handouts or on your handouts, the very last line is my email address. Okay. If you want to send comments, if you could at least start in the subject line, Islington Street. So in the 100 emails I get a day, I pick that one out. We are hoping to utilize the city's website to post things. Either announcements or conceptual plans or whatever that, you know, will be easily found by all of you. I think it would be really good, too. We took your information when you signed in today. We're going to start a database of contacts. And I know there are other groups out there already on Islington, the West End group or whatever they're called, right? I'm sure you have quite a database of names that it would be good for us to get or have access to, or at least have a person that could be our contact person from that organization, so that when we do have an announcement, we can reach all those people. So communication's big. I'm glad you mentioned it. Anyone else? Sorry we didn't bring refreshments. Well, thank you all. Like I said, you have my email address. Thank you.